Hi there, and thank you for joining us today at our very first online webinar about creativity in marketing communications. My name is Lera Geras. I'm head of branding department at NMX, and I will be your moderator for the next couple of hours. Let's start with the introduction. We're NMX, a digital marketing agency. We specialize in branding, creative comms, performance marketing, and product design for tech companies. Today, we'll have a great panel with the creative professionals from around the world, Serbia, Georgia, Dubai, and Singapore. We chose this topic about creativity in marketing communications because we, as an agency, know for sure that only creative campaigns can make some difference. And to create ones, you need to know how creativity works, develop an eye for the most great campaigns, and also have creative allies by your side. Before we start, I will tell you some details about organization of this event. We will have speakers, and each speaker will have from 20 to 25 minutes for the talk, and then from 5 to 10 minutes to answer your questions. So please don't be shy and send your questions to the comment section. We will try to reply to them all. So Picasso once said, every child is an artist. The question is how to remain one once we grow up. And today, with the help of our wonderful speakers, we will try to answer this question. Let's dive into the details about it, and I'm happy to introduce our first speaker, TK Teo, Associate Creative Director at BlueFocus Communication Group. TK will tell us about how thinking outside of the traditional boundaries of communication and marketing strategies has led to the most well-known and impactful campaigns in recent history, like Dove, Old Spice, and Apple. Welcome, TK. Thank you for joining us today. We know that it's almost midnight in Singapore, so you're truly our hero.
All right. Thanks, everyone. Hey, hi, everyone. Thanks so much for having me to kickstart today's webinar. And we have a fantastic lineup of speakers, you know, after me, and I'm really, really excited to hear from everyone and to also be inspired as well. Yeah, so like what your session is actually over, just slightly after 12 a.m. here in Singapore. So I just want to quickly thank those who are in the same time zone as me who are still dialing in here. And I hope that you'll truly be inspired after today's session as well. Okay, so before we get to today's topic, I just want to quickly do a introduction of myself. My name is TK, and I'm currently based in Singapore, and I'm currently the Associate Creative Director with BlueFocus. And BlueFocus is actually one of the largest advertising agency based in China, with over 6,000 employees working in over 100 offices globally. As a full-service ad agency, BlueFocus provides a wide spectrum of marketing and brand management services across, you know, things like digital, strategy, advertising, media, even PR and data in e-commerce as well. We work with the likes of, you know, the FMCG groups, as also together with the Fortune 500 companies, multinational companies, and leading Chinese enterprises as well, across the IT sectors, automobile sectors, even the entertainment industries. So yeah, I'm really, really excited to share today's topic. So what are we going to uncover today is three main things, right? So the first thing we want to look at is actually how brands are actually defined the traditional way and a conventional way of marketing. And these are the brands who are actually championing different ways of how to sell their product, sell their services in an unconventional way, in a way that is just a little bit more creative than what usually brands would do. And the second thing that we'll look at is the mechanics, right? The effects and the learnings of these groundbreaking campaigns that these brands are currently doing, have done for the past few years. And the last thing that we want to take a look at is, as a creative professional, right, what can we do to execute campaigns like this? What are some of the tips and tricks we can infuse into our next creative activation? So that brings me to today's topic, which is Beyond Ordinary, where we will dissect and understand how some of these brands really, really set themselves apart from each other in this industry. Okay, so the first case study, we'll jump right in. Anyone can tell me which client, which brand you think this is? If not, I'm just going to skip us and show you the next picture. Anyone? Okay, so for those who guys who know this campaign, it's actually done by Burger King themselves, along with their agency. So what Burger King really wanted to do, the brief that was given, was that they wanted to communicate Burger King's commitment to using fresh ingredients in its Whoppers, right? That was the brief, that they wanted to say that, hey, the Whopper is using ingredients that have, you know, no preservatives, all fresh ingredients only. And so what is the creative response that the agency had? Was that they used a moldy Whopper to show that the burger is made with no artificial preservatives, as opposed to a typical way whereby you would just market like the freshness of like the product to showcase the nice, delicious looking burger it is. But instead they went the other route to showcase something that is moldy, something that is super unconventional, unappetizing to even look at. But this really garnered a lot and a lot of like buzz and awareness throughout this entire campaign. So this was actually launched in 2020, February 2020, included a series of print, TV, digital ads that featured close-up images of Whoppers covered in mold, right? And the ads were all accompanied by the tagline, the real Whopper, the Whopper Day 35, 28, you know, the beauty of no artificial preservatives, just real food. So the campaign was also supported by a huge social media campaign that really encouraged people to share their thoughts on the ads. So the hashtag Modi Whopper quickly went viral, and the campaign generated a huge amount of online discussion. So you can see everything from your out of home to like your digital print, as well as your print magazine as well. And so what were some of the results that came from this execution was that it hit a staggering 8.4 billion impressions and leading to a total of $40 million dollars in earned media, and they saw a sales increase of 14%. And some other substats that you will see is there's a positive to a neutral sentiment of an upward of 88%, removal of artificial ingredients awareness, and an upward of 400%. And you can see the other stats in this fact sheet as well. So with these huge and overwhelmingly positive results, we're going to ask ourselves, right? Why did this idea, you know, how did this idea even work? So the first thing that why it worked, it's because of the shock factor that was attributed to this entire campaign, right? It went against the traditional glam images of marketing. There were no photos of a nice looking Whopper. The image of a moldy Whopper was used instead to, you know, really grab people's attention, to make them stop and think. You know, it was an extremely bold, extremely risky move that they did, but it really paid off in terms of generating buzz and awareness. So the use of these unappetizing images is a bold move, right? But it also broke the norms of food advertising, whereby they just don't portray the nice side of things. They went the other route to really showcase and how it captured widespread media attention and consumer attention as well. And the second reason is because they had an extremely clear, extremely concise message, right? It was super simple and super easy to understand that Burger King's Whoppers are made with no artificial preservatives. That's it. So this message also resonated with consumers who are increasingly concerned with like the quality of food that they eat. So it was super clear, really, really easy for them to understand. And so the next case study you'll look at, I'm not gonna let you guys guess, I'm just gonna put it out there, is by Taco Bell. And it's also another case study of how a brand, you know, shifted their way of traditional marketing to do something that is really, really exciting and cool. So the brief that was given by Taco Bell to their agency was that they wanted to reinforce their positioning as a cool, a very hip brand that really differentiated themselves from the crowded food, fast food market. And what was the creative response to this was that, once again, they challenged the concept of traditional F&B marketing, and they created a fully immersive and experiential Taco Bell pop-up resort for the fans. So in 2019, Taco Bell converted a Palm Springs hotel into a resort called The Bell, and they offered an immersive brand experience for the fans. And this hotel featured Taco Bell themed rooms, food, poolside cocktails, as well as merchandise. So Taco Bell took over 70 rooms of a hotel within California, in Palm Springs, California. And they created this really experiential and memorable experience for their guests. And this pop-up hotel featured food tastings, you know, synchronized swimmers, a poolside concert by Fletcher, a freeze lounge, as well as lots of like different activations that you can see over here. So from check-in to check-out, you know, the Bell Resort was way more than just a place to stay, right? It was way more than just a staycation idea. It was a way to really reinvigorate the love of both casual and the cult fans for the brand. So the Bell captured attentions before check-in. They had, you know, fans to talk about the teaser content, and they had a lot of like limited details released in media coverage. Even celebrities like Jimmy Fallon and Ellen DeGeneres also talking about this whole coveted experience. And this resort, they had everything that a traditional hotel and a resort would feature, right? But all with a Taco Bell twist, from your hot sauce inspired pool floats to your room key cards, to synchronized swimmers, which we saw in a slide earlier, to even a gift shop with custom Taco Bell souvenirs and resort wear, to an on-site salon, a hot yoga, and even a breakfast room service. So everything at a hotel was designed for the fans and really supremely on brand together with the rest of the things you see on the screen. So let's look at some of the results that happened through this entire activation. Right after announcing this pop-up resort, people went crazy. Right, they had a lot of like buzz and anticipation brooding from like your big media to your celebrities talking about it, and the rooms were all sold out, fully sold out in 2 minutes. And the people who are really, really brand loyalists of Burger King, they snapped out the reservations right within 2 minutes, and they traveled all the way from, you know, different 21 different states just to visit this pop-up store, this pop-up hotel in Palm Springs, California. And there were over 5,000 plus media stories that were curated and created. And the Bell's chatter accounted for 75% of Taco Bell's earned media impressions for the previous year. And through this activation, they had a total accumulated amount of 4.4 billion earned media impressions. And the best part of this was that the Bell actually drove the highest in-restaurant visits for the particular quarter. So once again, we want to ask ourselves the question, right? Why did this idea work? So first thing, instead of traditional marketing, Taco Bell created an extremely unique immersive experience. They pivoted their business from a fast food brand into a lifestyle brand for a short period of time during that 5 days takeover in Palm Springs. So they really, once again, you know, challenged the norms of advertising by really creatively changing their own industry from an F&B to a hotel industry. And the second thing that they did really well was that they were really, really smart, and they really, really understood their target audience. They identified this group of audience who are into both food and lifestyle. You know, hence they pivoted their business into a staycation lifestyle, and they really further enhanced the brand loyalists, and they really repositioned how they are really a cut above the rest of their competitors. Okay, so moving on to the last case study of the day, which I'll share. It's honestly one of like my favorite campaigns that I've seen in a while, in the past few months. To me, you know, creative work is always fun, right? It's always nice to win awards. It's always fun to do something quirky, something funny, something fun. But, you know, when you actually use your creativity to make the world a better place to live in, I feel that that is, to me, the highest form of this art that we are all pursuing in this industry. So that brings us to this campaign that was done by Talks. So the brief was actually set in Taiwan, and they want to increase awareness about the importance and the impact of organ donation in Taiwan, right? So in countries like Taiwan, there still has got to be some sort of like approval from a relative to donate organs, even if the person donating who has passed on already gave a pre-approval, right? But the problem that they're facing right now is that when the person passed on, the family members usually are overcome with grief, right? They're too sad, they don't want to talk about anything. And because of this period, the 36-hour critical window is often lost. And because of that, between 2020 to 2022, there were only 1,000 transplants that occurred, despite the fact that there were over 10,000 people on the waiting list. So what was the agency's response to this? They worked with like a various of health institutions within Taiwan itself. So together with the agency, they came up with an idea to allow the loved ones to communicate with the dead. Okay, so I really am excited to share this case study. So let's take a look at this video, and I'll just stop sharing for a bit.
你听过器官捐赠的黄金协商36小时吗？根据台湾现行捐赠流程，即使往生者已签署同意书，在最后关头仍需再世亲人同意才能正式执行，但这段时间往往来不及让亲人做好心理准备，与他们的挚爱道别。 许多器官捐赠成功的可能，就在这黄金协商36小时间终止。如果在这个关键的时间点能听见他的声音，也许他的生命就能以另一种形式延续。
爸，是我啦。希望你永远不会听到这段话。 但如果你听到了，就表示我没办法继续在你身边陪伴你了。我想，这一切应该发生得很突然，你可能还无法接受这个消息。很抱歉，让你一个人承受这一切。我想跟你说谢谢，让我在一个充满爱的环境下。 长大，如果可以，我也希望将这份爱传递出去。虽然我必须先离开，但可以让其他的生命在这个世界不同的角落继续努力的生存下去。一直以来，你都告诉我，要我成为一个更好的人。不论我做什么，你都会支持我。 希望你也可以支持我这最后的心愿。器官捐赠声纹卡，一个推升台湾器捐成功率的创新设计。
Okay, yeah, so, you know, when I first saw that ad, I think it was super powerful to me. And it's really a kind of creative idea that you see that, you know, once in a generation. So this, as you saw in the video, right, the whole campaign, which is about, you know, sharing the person's last wish, was really designed to address the issue, which we saw in the brief earlier, right? So, you know, potential donors can record their wishes, that they can play to their relatives upon their passing, and using this sound card, they can actually bridge the gap between life and death. And this is something that's extremely powerful to be used to facilitate communication with family members in the crucial window. So when this whole campaign was launched, what were some of like the very tangible results was that in June 2023, which is when the campaign was launched, it was incorporated into the Taiwan Ministry of Health and Welfare's official donation regulations. By December 2023, there were over 3,500 organ donations voice prints that were recorded, right? So Taiwan reported over 1,000 successful cases in that year. And this is its highest success rate in 10 years, and even historically up 33% year on year. So the best part about this is that this whole activation was implemented across all major Taiwanese hospitals. And every major Taiwanese hospital will carry a consent form that will also include a QR code linking to the organ donation voice print site, where donors can record their wishes at any time, stored for the future. So for the last time today, why did this idea work? Right? So first, they understood the power of emotions, right? TOSC understood the problem, which is lying within the emotional aspect of human beings, right? this was the problem that actually transpired to get people, you know, they were too sad to even talk about it. And they, instead of using a very bright, a very positive, a very sunny way to increase awareness for donation, they actually changed the problem into the solution by leveraging on the same exact emotional aspect of human beings. And they use this to change the whole narrative to allow the people who are, you know, who are not so inclined to do this to be very supportive of this. And the second reason is they had this really cool interactive installation, which was the sound card, which you saw in earlier in the video. So the use of interactive installations like this, where people could listen to the last wishes of those waiting for organ transplants, created a very personal and immersive experience. So this direct engagement made the issue of organ donation much more tangible and immediate, you know, really prompting individuals to reflect on their own potential to contribute positively to someone else's lives. Okay, so to conclude today, I have 3 points which answers the first a few slides that I mentioned earlier. In this era, right, where information is extremely overloaded, emotional engagement and storytelling is very, very important. Because when you have this kind of emotional engagement, which you saw in the last case study, it really cuts through the noise much more effective than conventional ads. You can imagine how a simple ad of, you know, just getting people to donate audience can be printed everywhere. But when you use emotional engagement to really showcase and set yourself apart, you know, talking about stories that invoke strong feelings, whether it's joy, empathy, or even controversy, you know, tend to stick with us a little bit longer. You know, encouraging the discussion and encouraging lots of potential upside to it. So this emotional resonance really built a deeper brand audience relationship, you know, ultimately fostering loyalty and advocacy. The second takeaway is that we should always leverage on digital and social media platforms, right? As you can see in the case study of the Bell Resort, digital and social media platforms, they offer a direct line to the consumers. They allow them allowing for like a two-way communication and real-time engagement. So this content can be shared very quickly, very widely, can go viral, especially when in Taco Bell, when, you know, Jimmy Fallon and Ellen DeGeneres talked about this, they exponentially increase the campaign's reach and impact with minimal investment. And the last thing of how we can make campaigns just a little bit more interesting, a bit more creative, is that we need to build some sort of authenticity and social responsibility. So to these consumers, especially like the younger generations, we are much more socially conscious and we expect the brands to support, to reflect their values. So by engaging with social issues authentically, you know, brands can really build trust and respect among their target audience. And this really differentiates the brand, but also at the same time, foster a sense of community and shared purpose in its consumers. All right, with that said, I've come to the end and I hope everyone is at least 5% more inspired by like the case studies I've shared. If not, I think it's just gonna be me. So thank you for the time. And if you want to connect, you know, just to talk a bit more, if there are certain case studies that you really are excited to share with me, I've you know, linked my LinkedIn on the QR code for us to connect. So yeah, thank you. Thanks everyone.
TK, thank you. Thank you so much for the great presentation. It's a pleasure to see your work. It's very beautiful and inspiring. And people in the comment section, they were writing that especially Taiwan campaign was really heart-touching, and I totally agree with them.
Yeah.
So the first question I'd like to ask comes from me, actually. So, and then we'll move on to the questions from the comment section. You know, we both working in creative professions, and we know that facing creative block is common. So I'd like to ask how you personally and your team overcome this hurdle to maintain a steady flow of innovative ideas.
Yeah, so I think as a creative, you know, when we reach mental blocks and like, you know, writer's block is extremely common, right? So I think a very tangible way of how you can shake things up a little bit just to reset the mind a little bit is you can change your environment a little bit, right? So something that I used to do with my teams or even myself is that I can't really stay in like a fixed space or like a fixed desk for too long. I need to go out there, I need to take some walks, I need to speak to some people, you know, just saying hi to people who is serving you like your coffee, things like that. You know, to really change our environment or routine can be something that is very critical to come up with your ideas. Because, you know, when we change up our routine, it gives way, you know, for our brains to kind of like explore new things. And with that in mind, you know, maybe the next best, you know, the award-winning idea might just come to you. Yeah. And also, another thing that I also used to do is to really use like mind maps to really talk about, like, you know, how from work clouds you just expand and expand, and also tap onto everyone, you know, to contribute to this kind of like a collaborative work. And, you know, once you have this kind of ideas, you know, put into place, then more often than not, you will have some pretty good stuff coming out.
Thank you. Yeah, mind map is a great tip, actually. And I'd like to ask you the next question. What do you think is the key to winning awards?
I think...
yeah, it's a tricky one.
It's a tricky one. But I think to win awards, you know, I mean, okay, taking all the rules and taking all of like the prerequisites aside, I think as a creative, if you really want to develop an award-winning idea, you need to be very bold with your execution. You need to be able to stand your ground. You need to really believe that what you're doing is actually for the better in the world. That you really use a positive impact to, you know, whatever outcome that will come, right? And once you really sell this idea to yourself, if you yourself can believe that this is an award-winning idea, then sell to 5 more people, sell to another 10 other people, right? So for me, I, you know, previously in all of the companies and the teams that I work with, whenever I sit down for like a creative concept, the first person I sell like the idea to after myself would be like my designers, my project managers. And before it reaches the client, we need to be on the same page, right? We really need to be able to understand that this is the idea that we are going for, and this is the idea we truly believe that would be the golden idea. Yeah,
thank you so much. And we have another question coming up. What do you think, what is the best way to conduct A-B testing? What steps should be taken if a campaign doesn't produce positive outcomes?
Yeah, so this is another interesting question. Thanks, Sarah, for that. Sorry if I'm pronouncing it wrongly. I think when it comes to A-B testing, there's a few things that we need to bear in mind. Right, because sometimes, like when we use creativity to come up with like a certain idea, it might not be resonating with the right audience because of certain reasons. So I think what we could do to kind of like potentially to take some preventive measures is that we don't try to go all out in all of like our creative outputs. We can do some sort of like seeding content here and there. If you are using influencers, you can get them to actually just get them to talk about it a little bit, just to make sure like you're not fringing any lines, you're also targeting the right audience. So once you have like, let's say 4 to 5 creative strategies that you are putting in place in this idea, you can take a look to see which ones are the ones that are actually performing well. And those are the kind of like stuff that you should be doubling down on. And if you receive anything that is like not too good, like some negative outcomes, those are the things that you should also take a step back or to really stop it. You know, because when you talk about, you know, creative ideas and like this kind of like bad publicity, yes, even though there's not really such thing as bad publicity, but there is still such thing as bad publicity, right? So some brands might not, you know, work with this particular person, or this idea might not work if there are some sort of like backlash. So try not to go all out try not to go out in the first few months, just to really see what is the market consensus is like. Then once you have more and more, you know, supporters, you have a bunch of like brand loyalists that is like supporting you, then that's where you really go all out. Yeah.
Thank you, TK. Thank you for all amazing cases that you've shared with us. And now we'll have to move on to our next speaker. And it's Ivan Gorbunov, lead architect at Kidz. And Ivan will tell us more about how creativity works, why having boundaries even in creative industries is important. And I hope Ivan will also show us some of their brilliant works, because I will have to be honest with you, NMX and Kidz, we are dearest friends and partners. And we know for sure that Kidz team creates really mind-blowing, even revolutionary architecture concepts that can really change industry. Yes, don't be shy, man. It's true. And now you will have to see it for yourself. Welcome, Ivan. Floor is yours.
Hi, thank you. Hi, everyone who is watching this on YouTube or anywhere else. It's nice to see you there. And it's a pleasure for me to speak to you today. My name is Ivan, as it was said previously, and I'm an architect at Kidz Studio. While I'm talking, you can try to scan this QR code and see where it takes you. But if you didn't do this, you can try to complete the second task and find me on this picture. Okay, don't try too hard. This guy with the most happy face is me. And before I start, I want to tell a few words about our studio. We call ourselves an experimental design studio, mostly because for the 10 years of our existence, we have managed to work with almost all possible scales. And of course, interior design is our main focus, and we are mostly famous for the interior design works, but we never refuse offers of other typologies, because if someone suddenly thinks that we should do a good job with the design of a whole city or tableware, why should we disagree with this? I think we shouldn't, and we never do. Now let's go down to our today's topic. Here is main points I want to highlight today, and almost each one is with an example from our own practice. I think we should start with the definition, because creativity is one of the most widely used words with the largest number of different interpretations. And most of them are true. Most of them are true. So to make my story straight, I gotta pick one, I think. And for me, to be creative is to combine incompatible. And it's clear for me that if you do that without a proper reason or a task to solve, it's easiest way to get a kitsch. But if you do have a problem or a task to solve, this is where things can get really, really interesting. And there is also an opinion I agree with. It's Pharrell Williams, who recently said that creativity without business is usually victimization, and business without creativity is a waste of time. So the point here is, if you are involved in any type of business, you gotta learn to combine incompatible to avoid waste of time. And I'll try to show you how it works with some examples from our practice, as I said before. The second point is why boundaries are necessary to be creative. Imagine someone reaches out to you and asks to make the coolest project ever. What's going to happen next? Probably you will just end up with a bunch of different ideas floating around in the air with no force to ground them. You just won't be able to decide which one is the best and worth implementing. This is why you need boundaries. Any idea you have will bounce within this invisible outline, just like this animation of an old DVD player. Oh, no, it's too expensive. This will take too long. Client won't approve this. I'm not sure this is legal, and etc. So it happens like this until you come to the result. And the specific root of this idea or a bunch of ideas and the point where it will end is actually your unique point of view in any project. And people often complain about limitations and boundaries, and this is one of my favorite pictures about how things really work, but it's not always like this. Here is an example of our project. It looks bright and quite simple. It's a small bar in the center of the city, just 30 square meters in total, but client wanted it to be a pre-party place with DJs on weekends and dancing, you know, 30 square meters, DJs. Sounds like combining incompatible, but we came to this decision. We made the back of the sofa on a lifting mechanism. It's not actually a sofa. It's a row of the puffs just placed together, but they look like a sofa when they are put like this. Tables are increased in height because there is a threaded telescopic connection inside this support of this table. And as I said before, the sofa is made of puffs with a ribbed shape. So it's not just like for a nice look. It was done to hide the joints between puffs when they stand in a row. So this is the result. Looks quite clear, quite nice, quite simple, but the process behind this result was quite a pain in our heads and minds, because it was really hard to pick a mechanism for the table. We had to measure those butt supports in the subways just to make the angle and the height correct. It was also a really painstaking job to find the right model of the folding chair, just so it looks nice and works nice and doesn't break in a week. So yeah, the first lesson from this first point is you should not perceive boundaries as a punishment from heaven, because without them, I think real creativity is impossible. And the main thing to avoid any pain during the project is to try to find out all the true boundaries as early as possible, because when they come out like in the middle of a project, of course, it causes a lot of pain. The third point is that you should set your goal and define a task. And in our field of practice, this is the client who usually does this job. And we had this particular case with one of our clients. He came to us and said, we need a pavilion for a 3-day brand exhibition, which we can then disassemble and turn it into a full-fledged corner in a shopping center. Oh, and also it has to look like wow, and we want to use all 6 meters of height available. So yeah, we're combining incompatible again. How the hell do we combine 6-meter high wow and a collapsible structure? We were lucky to have this rendering in our hands before this request came to us. And we just thought, yeah, it looks nice, we should do it. But the main thing is to make it collapsible, make it easily assemblable and disassemblable. And so we came to the scaffolding and balloons, just because it will allow us to create this look, and it will be the easiest construction to assemble. And so we did a lot of work elaborating this structure, doing everything to fit nice, and the most detailed drawings, so the contractors can do this in a really short period of time. And we succeeded. So, and we also managed to transfer this huge pavilion into a small full-fledged corner in other part of the city. So this looks a lot like the happy end story, but what's the point with the task? Let's just rewind a bit and check it once again if we did everything right. We did a pavilion that they could disassemble and turn it into a full-fledged corner. It looks like wow, and it's a really 6-meter height. But what did we forget? We forgot that the primary function of this pavilion was to advertise the brand. And if you take a closer look at this picture, you won't even probably find a single logo of the company of this client, because we kind of got so excited about this construction, about this idea, that us and client, like, we forgot about the one of the main points. So the lesson here is you got to make sure the task is correct, even if it's not yours, but client's. So that all your creative power of combining incompatible is directed the right way. Yeah. The creativity doesn't sound like something that you could really count and measure, because it's really, fluid. But I think I know a couple of instruments that will help you to really evaluate your ideas in spite of creativity. You can just take two scales, like put on the one end something less desirable, on the other hand something more desirable. And it's going to be horizontal. And take the other one, do it in a similar way, but put it vertically. So you will have two axes. And of course, if something less desirable and more desirable are on the ends, something that you really need and something that will work the best is the golden mean that lies on the intersection of these scales. And if we rewind back to this project with the blue balloons, this is actually the point we reached, and we got it only after completing the project, because we didn't know what will happen. And this is the point actually we should have reached, because like it should be more useful. It should have been more useful in spite of advertising the brand, and it could be a bit more cheap. But like this is the details, and I don't want to spend too much time on them. So and you can evaluate not only complete projects like this. When you're starting a project or you're working on one, you're always having a bunch of different ideas, and you don't want to waste too much time choosing between them, because they all have their pros and cons. You can use this simple tool to just place them in this coordinate system and decide which one you need. And it's not mandatory to use only these parameters. You can change them with any you need. So that's it. I think despite the vagueness of the concept, creativity can be measured. And the main thing is to choose the right scales and honestly evaluate your ideas. Because if you know that this one is really slow and complex, you can still choose it, because like it's worth it, and it solves the problem. So yeah, and when you did this, you should remember that you are the author of the project, and if you are combining incompatible and evaluating your ideas, you should do this in your own way, because you are the author and your vision of the task can be like really similar to the ideas you're picking, even if they're slow, complex, expensive, etc. Because you will never create a 100% perfect thing. There will always be something to improve next time. And here's the case from our practice. The task was to create the cafe in Dubai that will stand out among others and will represent the product. And this is our vision. This is not the rendering. This is a photo of a build project. But in spite of, you know, success, the overall success, it kind of didn't work out, because people in United Arab Emirates, as it turned out, have a really specific taste for interiors. And radically new things like this, caused them more rejection than interest. So we did a couple of more projects, improved our design. And both of these projects, the first one and the second and the third one, they're both really our vision. I think the outcome, the result can be called really creative. But just the second time, we improved it. We picked different ideas. And it was opened a month ago, so we don't know yet how much more successful it turned out to be. But anyway, you shouldn't be afraid of choosing and implementing ideas in your own way, because even if you turn out to be wrong or not 100% right, the experience will be useful in any case. And the last point will also be with the example from our practice. I think that when you create something, you should always try pushing a little bit too far just to see where it may lead. I mean, in your head, at least, you should do this. And this story about our studio and about our products is that one day we sat together and kind of thought, what if we make a piece of furniture from a material that is least likely to be made from? I mean, if you ever saw this thing in your life, it's usually like above your head on the ceiling, and it's for cables, for electrical cables. And we thought, why not, we should make a chair out of this, no? Yeah, good idea. And if we put this idea on two scales, like try to measure its creativity, it turns out that it's like almost the most cheap and fun idea that we could ever have, and that we couldn't probably ever use in any commercial projects, because like almost no client will agree to implement something that is just cheap and fun and almost not useful, because like why should I do this? And we did, because like we can. We did a prototype, we did a second one, and here it is. It's actually like a sneak peek, because we didn't release it anywhere. I think it should have been a secret, maybe, I don't know. But the point here is we just did it. It's the second prototype, and we don't know where this will lead us yet. But the act of implementing something crazy, something almost 100% not useful, you know, it's a really inspiring experience. So I really advise you to do something like this sometimes, just because it may increase your thought process, and like when you're doing this one idea, you can like get 5 or 10 extra ideas just in the process of doing this. So if you want to be first to know where this story will lead us, you can scan this QR code, and we will announce some info about this product really soon. I don't know if this is lesson 5 or the conclusion overall, but I think the whole life itself is a process of testing different ideas, and not just at your job, at your work, but like having a family is an idea, having a dog is an idea, and you're just testing. And then like, if you don't succeed, you just abort this operation. And I think sometimes if you dare to push far enough with any of these ideas, you can get unexpected positive results, or at least just have fun. Thank you. That's it.
Wow, Ivan, I'm so impressed by your report, truly. And I think that audience will agree with me. So thank you. Thank you for sharing all these projects. They look really huge, and I can't even imagine what an immense work stands behind all of that. So I'd like to ask you the first question. How do you train your creativity, and how do you find solutions for challenging tasks?
Well, actually, this instrument with the scales is one of the tools I personally use sometimes, because it really seemed to me for a few first years of practicing that it's really hard to choose. Like some people, they just don't have any idea, and they have to scroll Pinterest a lot, or like, I don't know, Behance, some other creative social platforms, just like to get this spark. But I had like an opposite problem, because when you have a task to solve, and you have like 100 ideas of doing this, you gotta pick one or two, because like there is only one solution in the end. So yeah, tools like this, they really help. And if you like break down this a little bit, the thing that really helps is just writing things down, because sometimes all these ideas, they just stay here in your head. And if you visualize them in any way, you can use any instrument convenient for you. But if you just take a piece of paper and a pen, things can get really better very fast.
Yeah, it's true. And what resources, maybe besides Behance and Pinterest that you've mentioned, you use to get inspiration from?
Well, you know, we in our studio, we have this chat for like all members of our studio. It's a separate chat, and we call it like private Behance. Because like we have people working with us like with a very different background. Some of our architects are like former costume designers. Some are, I don't know, into dancing or theater. And so every single person has his own sources of inspiration. And so we decided that we should exchange these you know, pictures and videos, because like, this guy is interested in cars. He can just drop some, I don't know, Porsche in this group, in this chat, and everyone is like, "Wow, yeah, this is great. I never thought about like what a Porsche could look like." And this girl can, I don't know, share a link of some theatrical performance, and we're also like, "Wow, I never thought that like things like this are created by somebody." And you know, I think it's really harmful to stay inside those Pinterests and our daily for architects, like all the time, because the best ideas usually come from different fields of, you know, creative process.
Yeah, right. As they say, teamwork makes the great work. In this way, I can say the same. And we have another question. It's very interesting. How to convince a client to launch a super creative and bold project? Because clients are often not so brave. Maybe you have a practice to collaborate with a client on the idea. Can you please tell us more about it?
Well, you know, I think we could do a separate online event on the client negotiations psychology, because this is really a huge topic. And I don't know, there is, of course, there is no universal technique or some magic spell that will convince your client like this. But I think the main point is you don't always have to push your creative idea to every client that is working with you, because the best project, the best design is done when you know the true wish, the true purpose of the client. Because let me explain on a simple example. Like you may have a client who comes to you and says, like, I want to open a bar or a restaurant. And when you're briefing him, when you're talking to him on the project, you kind of notice some weird weird stuff, like he's not interested in this at all, because it may not be his true motivation. He may not be into bars at all or restaurants. He just wants to impress somebody, or he wants to earn some money or invest into something, but he doesn't know quite well what it should be. And when client exposes his true motivation, his true wish to you, this is where the best ideas and best projects come to life, because this is where this spark happens. But if the motivation or goals are foggy and not clearly said, none of your creative ideas, which you are pushing hard, this just it just won't work.
Thank you, Van. Yeah, being honest is the key. And I will ask you the last question, I think, because we have to move on with our speakers. What would you recommend in order to identify the real boundaries of a project as soon as possible?
It's the answer is almost similar to the previous question. Like, it's the psychology of talking with the client, because I thought, I don't know, for maybe 2 or 3 years ago, that the only way to do this is to make, I don't know, five-paged, the brief on 5 pages with very specific with a lot of questions on the topic of the project, and make client to write everything. So you have all the information in a good time. But when I thought, if I were a client of a studio like this and I had to do this work, I think I wouldn't. I just wouldn't, because it's exhausting, it's boring, and it's all about talking, I think, in the end. I think before starting a project or where you're just starting it, you have to talk with the client as much as you can, but do it, of course, productively, because the more you know the person, the more you understand his true goals, the better project will turn out to be, and the less surprises will appear when it's too late.
Yeah, thank you, Ivan. Thank you so much for your presentation and for being honest with us, answering all this question. So let's move to our next speakers, and they are our very own teammates from NMX. It's Sonya Chekova, content marketing team lead, and Anastasia Scherban, creator. They will show us one of our own case studies and will share their secret tricks and tips on how to incorporate creativity into your marketing strategy. Welcome, girls! So happy to see you here. Can't wait to hear all about your work.
Hi, everyone. As there are already told. My name is Nastya, and today we are talking about creative that works. We will share some tips for daily creation and talk about some practice, what is helping us to stay creative every day and how it works on our project. We are Animix. We are a strategic partner for tech company for strong expertise in marketing communication, branding, and product design. We are a distributed team located all around the world, serving clients ranging from startups to global corporation. And our case study would be about social media marketing. Our client is a premium quality pet producer who aimed us to create a content strategy that will help them to be different from their competitors, to earn subscribers, and at the very end, to get sales from their social medias. So let's start and let's talk about it. First of all, we started our project with strategy and research because for us, strategy is a key part in every creative process. Strategy helps us to understand market, to understand our customers and competitors, and the most important, to find insights that help us to come up with brilliant ideas that works, that brights our hearts and hits hearts of our customers, of course. So we carefully analyze the market and the audience and the client products, and here are some things that we found out. When we looked it out at our competitors, we saw that most of them are talking about love and pleasure, how good is their food, get more meow from Whiskas, or your pet our passion from Purina. And that should actually work. And this is the first approach on what we talk in social media as a pet food producer. The second part is when we're talking about science and potential, when talking about technologies. Royal Canin said us to unleash potential of our pets. He said that they making healthy taste is good. And where here should be we? To answer this question, we go forward and take a look at our customers. The first thing that we mentioned, that sometimes our pets not as sweet as we used to think. They wake up you in 5 a.m., they ruin wallpapers, then they ruin your sofas and your shoes and all of your stuff, but we still love them. We support them and want them to be healthy and strong. And here is the second part, what we learn about our audience is that help them to be strong and healthy is a challenge too. Because sometimes pets just don't want it food that they were eating for their whole life. Sometimes it's just hard to find the first food for them. And here is when our brand could really help. We took two of these ideas about our competitors and about our clients and brainstorm a little bit and developed our idea. Our idea is that we love our pets no matter how hard it is to be a pet owner. And we, as a brand, we support our clients and help them to keep their imperfect pets active and healthy. So the key message of our communication was, there are not perfect pets, but all of them are beloved. And this idea was developing during our social media, and that's how it went. To communicate this big idea, we can create a content strategy that should tell us not only what we're going to say, but how we're going to say it. And for this reason, we developed a rubricator and what was inside of it. First of all, we included their content for going viral, product posts, tips, and community brand, community building content. We used memes, reels, and UGC to create emotional connections with our audience. We used tips for proper nutrition, to growing knowledge of our products, and to building image as an expert in pet nutrition. And we used user-generated content for better connection with our audience. A mix of these formats help us to grow knowledge about our products, create an emotional connection with our audience, and turn our subscribers into loyal customers. To support this idea, we create a photo shoot where we continue to develop our creative idea. We made bright photos with pets, with bright brand colored backgrounds and in natural poses. You can see that someone of these animals are scratching, someone is playing, someone is licking package of the food. And that's how they are. They're active, they're healthy, they're strong, they're playful. And that's why we love it. So, and that's what we needed to do. In our design, here is our mood board that we developed for our social medias. We decided to use playful scratches, active bold typography to make bright accents, and bright and dark photos that should translate our idea of premium brand, premium quality brand, and to help us to be in modern and innovative brand. And here is our results. Here you can see Mishis, you can see some sketches, and healthy, strong pets that just living their best life and having fun with their owners. Next thing that I want to tell you is a special product for social media. This is a special time for everyone because we knew that during this time, our clients are really busy by buying gifts, by playing their New Year Eves, and we needed to find a way to grab their attention. We decided to focus on our brand, the main brand topic of imperfect pets, and created storytelling contest when we suggest our subscribers to share some stories about their pets and make some sum up the year and make some plans for the next when we're talking about mischiefs. And the results of our products of our project was really impressive. We get more than 100 participants in our context. We got a lot of comments, and we got a boost of subscribers. But what I think is the most important in this part, here's some photos of our subscribers who shared what they did during the year. And as we can see, our subscribers feel the pain too. So the most important part and what I like the most in this context was this comment. That's really reflect our idea, but here's the words of our subscriber. She said that she subscribed and read comments, so much laughter and love for animals in the stories. And after all, not a single owner thought of kicking out their pets. On the contrary, they love them even more. So, in summary, creativity played a crucial role in our success. We did a huge work developing this strategy and developing this content. Of course, here is like really, really, really short version of our strategy, of our case, of our work. But it works. It helped us to convert random people on the internet into our subscribers, and what is the most important in our buyers. So our client enjoyed this strong media, social media presence, and that's it. I guess that's it for this case study. Now Sonya will share with you how to do this creative that works and how to practice your creativity on a daily basis.
Yep. Hello, everyone. My name is Sonya, and now we'll talk about creativity and some things which help us be creative and make great projects. Most of them helped us when we worked on Melvin, of course. And let's talk about what helps us and you be creative. I want you to think about some stuff that help you with creativity. Maybe it's something really simple, or maybe it's something unexpected. You can write that in the chat if you want. And here on the next slide, we see some basic things which I believe are deeply important in the creative process. And let's talk about how to create a system for consistent and effective creativity. With my team, we are trying to build a safe environment, be open-minded, and check the state of each member of our team. If we see someone work too hard and is exhausted, we tell them to take the day off. A safe environment is really important for the creating process, because if you don't feel safe, you can't freely share ideas, which is highly important when you're trying to come up with something truly great. We're constantly working on our observation skills. We even have a group call, which is called Planet of Content. At the meeting, we watch brand content, festival commercials, and else. After watching, we try to figure out how to use what we saw in our projects. Also, you must believe in your team. Micromanagement is really dangerous, and it can kill creativity. One of the bases of our creative process is brainstorming. So let's talk about it. Brainstorming can be really fun, inspirational, and exciting process. And that's what we're trying to achieve at every meeting. What helps us? First of all, icebreaking. We need people at the meeting to feel free to share their thoughts and ideas. So we ask them something about the morning, or a cactus, or a cat, or we just joke and talk about something from our lives. The next one, tune our brains into the creative way. If we are working with people who don't usually create something, we can use some exercise which help to think out of the box. Of course, you can use creative warm-ups from the internet, or you can try this one. You can screenshot it if you want, and I hope it will be helpful for you and your team. And the next important thing is the agenda. You should arrange clear boundaries and tell everyone what we are trying to achieve today. Our goals must be clear so as not to get lost in the process. And then we just share ideas. Everything must be written down. And one of the most important thing, we try not to be critical at the moment, because we need as many ideas as we can accept. At the end of a brainstorm, summarize everything, thank everyone, and tell which ideas was most amazing. When we're brainstorming and trying to come up with something that hits customers in their hearts, we use some tools which help us to do it faster and easier. There are a few on the slide. It's Miro, which we use for brainstorming, Notion for making notes and lists, and that's Figma for collecting design boards, Pinterest, where we share with all members of our team stuff which we just save. It's everything which we think can be inspirational or just useful. And of course, we use IE tools like ChatGPT or Midjourney. It helps with ideas from which you can build of something cool. Or it can help you with visualization. Sometimes when you can't see what are you thinking about, it really helps you to understand what's going next in your creative process. And this is it. Don't take creativity as something mysterious. It's manageable, especially when you know how. And thank you all for the attention. And if you have some questions, you're more than welcome to ask.
Thank you, Sonya. Thank you, Anastasia. It was very wonderful to listen about your work, especially Melvin campaign, and people in the comment section were writing that it's the cutest campaign they've ever seen. And it's true. And I think that talking about pets, making campaign about pets, it's always such a pleasure. So back to the basis, our questions. And Anastasia, you mentioned that strategy lies in the basis of your work. Can you please tell us, how do you conduct research that lets you find this kind of customer insights for your campaigns?
Thank you. That's a really great question, because I think strategy is like things that everyone who doing creative should use every time. Even if you don't have a strategy in your team, you can do it by yourself. And here is some sources that you can use to find those wonderful insights. First of all, it's statistics and researches that you can learn on the internet. Obviously, on the topic that you need. For example, if you're interested in pet, you can Google how often, I don't know, people change their cat's nutrition during their life and why they do it. Second thing that you can Google is some trend reports, because when you know trends, you understand how not only few people, but a lot of people, how they think, how they move, and how they change their opinion, and what is the hottest topic that they want to discuss with you. Third thing that I want to tell is social looking. When you are going through social medias, you read comments, you look through memes, you go through the forums, and here's a way that you can learn a lot of things about your audience when you just read what they're talking about. You're like the one who is listening why others are talking, and here's where some really brilliant insights are hidden. And of course, you need to talk to the people. You can make interviews, you can talk with them just when you're drinking coffee or when you're in your break during your work time. So, and here's you can find some really interesting thoughts that you can after it proof with some reports, with some statistics, with some trends, so you can be sure while using it, and be sure that this is the topic that hits to hearts of your customers.
Thank you. Thank you, Nastya, for sharing your thoughts on this topic. And I think the next question is for Sonya. Sonya, how can companies boost engagement and conversions on social media by optimizing their presence?
Well, it depends. But I guess there is some tools that can help everyone. And it's, of course, memes. Everyone loves memes. You just see users-generated content. When you use something that people share in comments, and maybe they send you something, it's really helps with engagement. And of course, this is video, like reels in Instagram, especially when it's also something funny, it's working every time.
Yeah, you've talked about memes, and I should mention that we at Enemix, we have our own meme factory in our creative department, and the girls, they are part of this department, obviously. So the last question I will ask, and then we'll move on to our next speaker. We've talked with Ivan about consumer psychology, client psychology, and in your experience, what does consumer psychology play in crafting these campaigns that you've showed us, and what helped you to make these campaigns resonating deeply and becoming unforgettable for the customers?
Well, of course, customer psychology is important. And when we're searching something about our audience, we're trying to figure out what kind of content they prefer in social media. And of course, memes play a huge role. And this is the content that people usually like because everyone needs something funny and cheerful these days. And we can see that through our results when we check in statistics and results of our projects in social media too. Yeah, this is it.
Thank you so much. Thank you, Sonya. Thank you, Anastasia. And here we go. The last but not least, our next speaker, Karim Sherif, Executive Creative Director at Magnitude Digital, ex-Agili, Impact BBDO, MNC Saatchi, and Havas Middle East. And I'm saying all of this on purpose. I'd like to emphasize that Karim is a true expert in crafting experiences that not only capture attention, but also convert it into tangible outcomes for brands, means money, of course. And it will be very interesting, especially since Karim will show us and will share with us his very own experience working with IKEA and sneakers. So welcome, Karim. Thank you for being here with us today.
Thank you very much, Lira. It's a pleasure to be here. And I want to thank everyone who spoke earlier. Truly amazing insights and lovely information. And I hope lots of people watching have learned a lot. And again, thank you for having me. So today's topic that I would like to share with our audience, if I'm going to share my screen. Hang on a second. Yeah. Right. So today I chose an interesting topic, which is all about creative conversions. Creative conversions could mean lots of things, mainly also how effective creativity could really achieve decent results when it comes to an example like turning a brand or turning a product into an actual currency, something that you can actually use and formulate a proper relationship with, something that is valuable. And at the same time, when we talk about conversions in the retrospect, it could mean any other things. How do you convert, you know, the brand to romance, to for you to fall in love with it, for you to convert a brand to become something that is part of pop culture or life, based on truth, based on flawless truth. And we're gonna see this unfold in detail as we move along. So first, let's talk about a very interesting equation, which goes back to the famous phrase, you know, time is money. And it's not just a metaphor. It's a tangible reality. Today, any amount of time you spend, whether you are thinking about an idea, the every minute you are spending brainstorming with your teams, delving through the strategy, doing your research on, you know, competition or anything else, this is all passing time, and it's very valuable because with every passing second or minute, you know what I mean, that process could lead to something great. And on the other end, you've got your clients probably counting every single minute you are spending thinking you know, and they're thinking about, you know, oh, well, we're paying this agency, they better hurry up with whatever they're waiting for. So it's a very intricate system and it's completely intertwined. It's a truth, you know, time and money are intertwined. There's no doubt about that. And as a rhetoric or as a solid piece of thinking, if it's what is adapted to creativity into teams, into agencies across the border of all boundaries and borders of thinking, what could creativity look like if you apply this rhetoric? And we're not talking, you know, brand love via loyalty cards or your coffee stamps or anything like that. No, truly putting the brand and what the client needs for the brand at the center of that circle. And having said that, we would like to share with you two interesting creative projects or examples that have actually within recent times have actually proven this to be true. The first example I'd be honored to take you through is what was done here in Dubai in the Middle East, what started as a very basic brief given by IKEA. I'll give you a little bit of backstory before we delve into this. This brief was quite simple. There was a new IKEA branch opening on the other far side town of the city. And the brief was very simple. It was an announcement brief. Oh, we're opening a second IKEA, but this time it was another very far store. And while brainstorming with the team, it just came to us, okay, what do we do? Do we just do what the client wants or what is needed for that store to have footfall, to go fully operational, effectively? And the strategy that was sort of conjured at the time was pretty simple. You all know IKEA is a worldwide, global, famous Swedish brand, and everybody does go there and buy things a few times. But when you do go, you practically probably do it on a Sunday or something, or you take a day off so you can spend a lot of time there. And that made a lot of sense, that you drive quite a bit because they're out of town. You walk around aisles and aisles of different products. You could easily lose yourself. Putting that truth in the center we are talking about is what happened here. And allow me to share with you, buy with your time.
IKEA's giant superstores are usually built on the outskirts of cities. As a result, families spend a lot of time driving to the stores. Could IKEA give them a stronger incentive to make the trip? IKEA's Buy With Your Time promotion was conceived as a way to reward people for traveling to IKEA. They could use the time they spent on the road to actually buy things in our stores. Everything in the store had a tag that showed the price in money as well as time. During checkout, shoppers just had to show the cashier their Google Maps timeline, which would have a record of all their past trips. Converting that time into an amount in UAE dirhams was a simple calculation based on the average family income in the country.
Would you like to pay by cash, card, or by your time?
Cash or time? At the moment, I can see that you have 2 hours, 35 minutes.
Can I pay for these small items with my time?
For this one item, sir, that's a total of 45 minutes. And for these three items, it's a total of 1,800 dirhams, sir.
That on time, this on card.
As expected, this novel promotion was an instant hit.
Have I got anything left over for hot dog, maybe?
After all, this was the first time that anyone had changed time literally into money, or for that matter, into a shelving unit, a coffee table, or a potted plant.
Yeah, So having done that, we went back to the client with this idea. And obviously you had your challenges and how can it be done and will there really be money for us in it as a business, which is another thing we thought of, which was like, yes, absolutely. And from such an initiative, it was requested by other IKEAs in different markets across the globe that they wanted to apply this because the insight has flawless truth in it across the globe. And it was taken and done and experimented with and ended up being something that probably a lot of brands are trying today to kind of sort of imitate or do. The second example I would like to take you through, it's a very different type of brand, very fun brand, one of my favorites personally, Snickers. Now, again, this is an example of very, very imminent truth and wonderful, wonderful, wonderful thinking from the core. You're hungry, you're not you. Eat a Snickers, you'll return to your normal self. Now, building on that, the idea came to like, okay, when you are hungry, sometimes you make blunderous decisions. You could make mistakes that can actually cost you a lot of money. Maybe you fall to an email or SMS scam and you were hungry or you didn't have lunch or whatever. Maybe you you forgot your key in the car and you can't get back in. It is rather frustrating. Simply put, why not turn the product, again, putting it in the center of the rhetoric, into a currency, becoming insurance. So if you've made a mistake while you were hungry, send us a claim and the insurance will pay you back in Snickers bars. Here's how it went.
Eat a Snickers.
What?
Because you get a little angry when you're hungry.
Everybody knows you're not you when you're hungry. So Snickers introduced hunger insurance. The first and only insurance that covers you for the mistakes you make when you're hungry, paying you out in Snickers bars to get you back to being you. Just like any other insurance, we kick things off with an infomercial.
Speak to one of our helpful hunger insurance experts and get your compensation today.
Anyone who thought they'd made a blunder when they were hungry could come make a claim on our site, where an AI bot developed with real underwriters calculated people's claims. After giving basic info about their mishap, the bot measured the severity and frequency of the blunder from keywords in Google data. Time and location let the AI judge how likely it was due to hunger or not, based on data for the hungriest times of the day and the hungriest locations. Calculating in seconds a payout between 1 and 50 Snickers, given as a digital coupon, redeemable at stores across the UAE. We processed and paid out countless claims, damaging personal property, booking the wrong holiday, ruining your clothes. As long as it was down to hunger, we covered it. Successful testimonials helped us reach as many hungry souls as possible.
There's a radio thirsty that's when it all happens.
Social, outdoor, in-store, and audio ads on Angami also drove our noble quest. People loved that we had their back, as Snickers got people's lives back on track and back to being them.
I don't know if maybe some of you have caught me there being the insurance salesman. But yeah, I mean, that's what you do when you ain't got a lot of budget sometimes. In conclusion, I just wanted to say that, you know, these are the sort of philosophies that could push the boundaries of performance to create sort of brand formance, which is the love for the brand and how it performs using flawless truth. and creative thinking that utilizes the best self of a brand. The best self of the brand being its true insight and its true core and what it stands for. In the case of Snickers, it helps you when you're not you, when you're hungry. In the case of IKEA, yes, the stores are far. How do you make the customer, you know, more involved? Time spent is time earned. And given the fact that we are entering, you know, this new and interesting age with technologies and AI, I think, you know, as if we use them as tools in the right way, the future of bringing brand and performance together could truly turn time into money, and maybe even introduce a new law, which the scientist in me tried to put out there with M equals RT. only time will tell, I suppose. And I just wanted to also talk about a little bit about the brainstorming tools, or the certain aspects to keep in mind when you're trying to think alongside this type of rhetoric, how to converge creativity. And I called it FEMSA, which is, you know, your standard, basically first letter of rules to follow so you don't forget. Flawless truth. Find that flawless truth, not something that is absolutely pure, an insight that is unbreakable and brutally honest. Explain the idea in one line, whether you're explaining it to your chief creative officer, whether you're explaining it to your team, whether you're explaining it to a client. Try as much as possible to just wow them and say it in one line. What if you could buy with your time? What if you pay out insurance if you're hungry? Just try to explain it in one line. If you can't, then move on. Make it desirable to engage. When you engage with your audience, don't just engage for the sake of engaging and getting your like button and that's it. No, interact with meaning. Get something out of them. Get money out of them. Get their love for the brand out of them. Any idea also following that specific rhetoric, you got to see it through till the end, from the moment of its conception to the results, to how it survives the landscape, from everything from how you're pushing it forward in terms of PR, in terms of earned media, how it extends. You've got to see it through the end, you and your team. The last thing is make it a wanted need, not a needed want. Like, innovate ideas from the sheer awareness of what is needed for the brand, not what the brand wants or what the client wants. Find what the brand needs. And following perhaps some of this, you know, could help us achieve creative conversion efficiently. Thank you very much. And if you want to connect, I liked what TK did earlier, and Ivan and the rest of the bunch with the whole QR code thing, so I quickly whipped up one myself. And here it is, in case anybody wants to connect further on down the line. Appreciate it. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Karim, so much. Nobody told me that you were also a movie star. Seeing you in this ad next to Joe Pesci was really fascinating experience. Thank you for that. And also, I think that you've put out valuable information, and it was inspiring listening to your report. And let's move on to our question, and I will let myself be curious a little at the start. Looking to the future, what emerging trends do you believe will significantly impact how brands attract their customers?
Looking to the future, what significant trends?
Emerging trends right now, because you've mentioned artificial intelligence. What else?
I do hope they don't turn out to be trends, because trends tend to die and they tend to become a fad for a while. I remember do you remember during COVID there was an app called Clubhouse? It was an app that sort of everybody, you push the button and it's all of a sudden you're kind of like instant podcasting with everyone discussing stuff. And at the time, I thought that was a hit. I thought, like, this is, you know, social media converted, you know, into significant multimedia at the same time. But it became a trend and it died quickly. I hope this isn't the case with what's happening, and some of what's going on are utilized as tools. Of course, I mean, you know, earlier ChatGPT was mentioned. I'm not necessarily a fan at the moment, because when you do this for a while, you can easily spot out if it is completely AI written or not. Use it but always put your mark on it, always paraphrase, always double check, always put some love in it, because the reward is much nicer and it's much higher when it comes directly from the flawless truth that's inside. Again, when it comes to art direction, for example, you know, many, many things, yes, they are up and coming. There's a storyboard AI bots right now. You can literally type in and have a storyboard in seconds. Again, not entirely advisable. It's still nice to have someone human put in the angles, put in the touch, whether you're doing anything from a social media reel to a big production. I think the balance is important, and it's probably something that is there, like keeping the balance and not letting the trends take over. And instead of calling them trends, we sort of adapt into utilizing them as tools, just as the typewriter became Microsoft Word or iLife. This is the new, I don't know, you know, tools that we used to use.
Yeah, thank you so much. I totally agree with you on that. And our next question is, how do you measure the success of a campaign in terms of conversion and not just engagement or reach?
Oh, it's a tough question. How do you measure?
I got you right there.
Look, there's my favorite, let's say, measurement metric is definitely PR. I like how the PR around that surrounds an idea does carry it forwards quite interestingly. It leads to it becoming infotainment and infotainment that is newsworthy, as opposed to, you know, just the numbers. But of course, absolutely, like conversion in terms of actual sales. Many other different ways to measure it per se. We had, especially in the last two cases, there was high engagement, high measurement, high sales, in terms of the journey itself. The measurement came from the footfall. It came from the amount of customers that immediately interacted heads on over there. It wasn't just measured directly through the analytics that were particularly from social media and what have you. Again, also, you had Google Analytics via the maps, for example, or via the coupons that were sent out. Though that measurement instantly did convert a lot of results in that retrospect. So there was still proper measurement done. However, combine that with the significant PR and earned media that was done, that saved up, combine that with the on-ground engagement via deactivation itself, it does give a quite better results than just relying on, you know, the traditional way of the study.
Thank you for sharing this with us. Thank you, Karim. It was a pleasure having you with us today, and thank you for all your answers. And thank you to everyone who joined us today and who asked some questions. We hope that this webinar was helpful and you've got some insights on how to boost your creativity and bolden your communications. Don't forget to hit the follow and like buttons, and see you at the next event. Thank you so much. Bye.